My name is Zach Terry, and I'm the president of Maximum Life. I hope you enjoy today's broadcast, and I hope you remember that it's made possible because of the generous financial support of people just like you. If you would like to learn more about supporting this ministry, visit us online at zachterry.com. Now, without further ado, here's today's broadcast.
Luke, the 10th chapter. If you have your copy of God's Word, open it up to the book of Luke. Find chapter 10 with me. The passage that is before us today in our study through the Gospel according to Luke is commonly referred to as the Good Samaritan. It's one of the most recognizable stories in all of the Bible. Hospitals have been named after this story. Organizations, institutions, movements have all taken this story as their theme passage. Believers and unbelievers alike know some portion of this story. You may have heard it before, you may have heard it wrongly, you may have heard it misquoted, but you will recognize the elements of the story that we're looking at this morning. And that kind of makes it difficult for an expositor to tackle. It's difficult to preach. Because it is familiar. You kind of enter into it as if you already know the point. You know where it's going. But hopefully this morning we can mine some new jewels out of this old mine. As Jesus moves in his journey from the upper regions of Israel and Galilee down toward the capital there in Jerusalem, his face is set like flint. We read a couple of weeks ago toward Jerusalem. And he's making his way from that rural territory into the metropolis of the capital city. As he does so, he's going to encounter some new arguments. He's going to encounter some new thinking. People are wealthier near the capital. People are more highly educated near the capital. And so the arguments and the challenges he faces will be more complex and astute. They probably presumed that this rural preacher who had developed an unforeseen following could be quickly made to hush because he was nothing more than a redneck from Nazareth. They were mistaken. Look with me in verse 25. And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" Now, you may or may not know this if you're new here at FB First. We have an abundance of lawyers, people of the legal profession, in this congregation. In previous churches, I may have had one or two. At last count, we had at least 15 attorneys in this congregation. I don't know what the Lord knows that we don't. But he sent them to us for some reason. And so far, I've liked them all. I honestly, I've not met one that I didn't think was a pretty cool person. They were fun to talk to. They think differently. They think their workings with logic. It's just really impressive. As a matter of fact, I don't know that I've ever met a lawyer that I didn't like to some degree, except that guy over Morgan & Morgan. Nobody needs that many commercials. But the lawyer in our text today is not that type of lawyer. He is an ecclesiastical lawyer, not a civil lawyer. These are men who served the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was made up of 70 men of good repute. There were 70 typically highly educated, pillars in the community type people. And they were the people who made decisions as to the application and the implication of the Mosaic law. the theological law. And they had these people under them who helped them with that process and that job. And that was the type of lawyer that this guy was. He knew the minutiae of this ancient Hebrew text. He understood how it all fit together. So here comes Jesus, this marginalized Galilean peasant, up toward the capital city, and now he's encountering this well-educated man who knows his theology well, and the scripture tells us here in verse 25 that he is intentionally testing Jesus. And so he's going to see what Jesus is made of. He's going to ask him a very difficult question. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? That's a good question. It's one that we all should answer. By this point in time in the Jewish theology, they understood that there was a resurrection. They didn't all believe in it, but they knew that there was a possibility of resurrection, that a person would die because we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but then one day God would raise us for the kingdom, for everlasting life. And the lawyer says, what must I do to get in on that? What must I do to inherit eternal life? And he, in verse 26, that is Jesus, said to him, what is written in the law? How do you read it? Now, he's asking him, what does the Bible say? What is your understanding of it? What is your interpretation of it? He takes one question, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And he answers it with two questions. Now, that's just something that the Jews have a tendency to do. They answer questions with questions. From our travels to Israel, I've developed some friendships with Jewish tour guides and Jewish hotel operators and different things, and I've noticed they always do that. You ask a question, what time does this happen? They'll say, well, what time would you like it to happen? They answer a question with a question. I asked one of my friends, Jacob, I said, Jacob, why do Jews always answer a question with a question? He said, why not? A properly framed question, as we've already seen, is one of the greatest tools in a teacher's arsenal. And so he says, what does the law say, and how do you interpret what the law said? So verse 27, and he, that is the lawyer, answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Now that answer is a combined quote of two prominent Old Testament passages. The first is Deuteronomy 6, verse 4. It's called the Shema. A devout Jew would have repeated that, quoted it out loud twice every day. When they come together in synagogue, which was like their church, that would be spoken over the synagogue service as part of their call to worship. And it was the idea, it says in Deuteronomy 6, verse 4, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. So we don't serve a multiplicity of gods like the Greeks or the Romans. We are monotheist. We serve one God. The Lord our God is one. In that day, if you were going on a sea voyage, you would make a sacrifice, perhaps, or make an offering to Poseidon, the god of the sea. If you were going to war, you would make a sacrifice to Mercury. If you were going to give a speech, you would make a sacrifice to Hermes, the god of oratory. But they were saying, years and years ago, they were the first monotheist as a people. And they're saying, hear, all Israel, the Lord our God is one. And then the implication of that is, and you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart. So you don't divide your heart up between these various gods based on who your tribe is or where you live at or what you're doing. Your whole self belongs to one God, and you're to love him with all your heart, all your soul, and all your might. Then the last part, he said, the second one is like it, Leviticus 19:18. where it says, you shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your own people. That's important. That's the context of it. But you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. So this lawyer says, my understanding, if you want to inherit eternal life, you got to do two things. Love God with everything and love your neighbor as yourself. But the context of that second passage is tricky. And there are whole schools of thought developed around it. Because the context is, you don't hold a grudge against your own people, but you love your neighbor as yourself. So the question that he's going to ask in a moment is, who is your neighbor? Because if we're talking about our four and no more, that's not that hard. Of course we're going to love. And if they go to the same church as us, we all kind of pull for the same football team, we all kind of vote the same way. If we're all on the same page here, okay, I got it. I've got to love those people. But what about those other people? What about those people who don't worship where we worship at? They don't vote like we vote. They don't think like we think. Do I have to love those people or not? That's going to be the loophole that this lawyer is going to try to exploit. Maybe they're not as different from our lawyers as I thought. But they do, he sees a loophole here. Other than that, it's a good answer to a good question. On another occasion in Matthew chapter 22, a different lawyer asked Jesus, what is the great and the foremost commandment? So Jesus, there's 613 commandments in the Old Testament. What's the most important one? Well, Jesus didn't say, well, you fool, they're all the same. He said, no, there's one that's weightier than all the rest. And he quoted the Shema. He quoted, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And he said, and the second one is like unto it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. So he gave the same answer about the most important law in the Bible. The understanding would be, those are really the only two commands. Love God with all your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. The Ten Commandments are commentaries on those two commandments. So you have four commands that are vertical. They're man to God. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. So how do you do that? You remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. You know, those are the vertical commandments. Then there are horizontal commandments. There's six of those. And that's man to man. Love your neighbor as yourself. So you have the two, you have the ten, and then you have 603 other commandments that pertain to any number of issues. And they can be understood as commentaries on the ten. So here, the lawyer answered well. He said, that's the most important thing. So I'm presuming that to go to heaven, I've got to do those two things. Jesus, in return, in verse 28, said, you have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live. Now think, if you can, from your conception to your expiration, love the Lord your God perfectly, with all your heart, and that you can, if you can look at every person and love them as much as you love yourself, then you have no sin nature. You will be perfect. And by virtue of your perfection, you shall enter into eternal life. There's a major problem with that. None of us are perfect. And we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Sin, in Scripture, is a term that was used in archery. It means to miss the bullseye. You miss the bullseye, it's called a sin. Now, there's some greater sins and lesser sins, just like there are greater commandments and lesser commandments. But if you hypothetically could live a perfect life by virtue of your innocence and your perfection, you could enter into heaven. But that's only been done one time, and that was by Jesus himself. So it would, you know, you would think that the lawyer would go, I have a follow-up. There's a problem. I haven't done that perfectly. I never have perfectly loved God, not a moment in my life, and I never have really loved my neighbor as I ought to. So is there any hope? To which Jesus may have said, of course. You see, there's a sacrificial system that teaches that your sins can be atoned for, that another could die in your place, and that you would have hope of eternal life through the substitutionary atonement of another, of whom John the Baptist said, "Behold the Lamb of God." All of those lambs and all of those oxen were shadows and types of Christ, who came to take away the sin of the world. So that would have led it in an entirely different direction. But look at verse 29. It says, "But he," that is the lawyer, "desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, 'Who is my neighbor?'" The greatest threat to your future is the sin of self-justification. It's a mega theme that's strung all throughout the Gospel of Luke. You remember, Jesus will tell us at another time, two men went to the temple to pray. One, a tax collector, the other, a Pharisee. The Pharisee prays, "Oh God, I thank thee that I'm not like all these other men." Now, he's giving God the credit. It seems like he's going on the right path. He says, "God, I thank you that I'm not like all these other men. I pray twice a week. I give tithe of all that I get. Not like that publican over there." The publican, it says, afar off, is beating his chest and saying, "Have mercy on me, a sinner." And Jesus says, "That man went home justified." The implication is the Pharisee who tried to justify himself by virtue of his good works didn't go home justified. Self-justification is the biggest threat that you have theologically to your eternal life. The whole point of the gospel is you can't do that. You can't save yourself. At the end of the matter, there's only two religions on planet Earth. One that says you're a sinner in need of a Savior, and God has provided that Savior in His only begotten Son. The other one says, give it a shot. Join our church, get baptized, you go to Sunday school, don't cuss so much, don't drink so much, and you'll get to heaven. Good works, self-justification. It's the only two. You look at any other religion other than Christianity, and it's some form of good works, is it not? You know, go on this pilgrimage. Die in a religious war. Memorize these pillars. Go on this mission trip. All of the other religions of the world have some mixture of works attached to them, but the true gospel, true Christianity says, if Jesus doesn't save me, I'm sunk. That's the gospel. It's only Him, only Jesus, you see. And so here, this guy is putting his chips on the other way, attempting to justify himself. So he says, you know, this controversy that's been going around about who the neighbor is. Who is my neighbor? Now, interestingly, it seems that he thought he might slip into heaven on a technicality. A legal loophole. Moses didn't define neighbor. So gotcha, Jesus. How am I supposed to know who my neighbor is? And how am I supposed to love him as myself if I don't have a clue who we're talking about here? It reminded me of the case against President Clinton back in the 90s. It depends on what the definition of the word is. The idea that concrete truth can get fuzzy in the existential reality that he was privileged to inhabit. Well, the grand jury didn't buy it, and neither does Jesus. Jesus replied, and he gives the story, the familiar story. He says, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, which is, remember, we said Jerusalem is the pinnacle of elevation. It was the city set up on a hill. And now this man is going on the Jericho Road. And that Jericho Road, some of you have been there. And if you remember, it leads through a canyon that is called the Valley of the Shadow of Death. It was a very dangerous area. 17 miles. that you would travel from Jerusalem to Jericho. Jericho is set in the wilderness. Jericho is an oasis. It was in ancient times, and it is today. It's an oasis where people would congregate and they would live. So this man is going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers. We're told that there are thousands in that day of robbers who would make their living just hijacking, catching people alone on the Jericho road and robbing them of everything they had. Even to this day, that road is so dangerous that if a rain comes, it's impassable. In those days, that road was called the Way of Blood. You didn't take this journey alone. But for some reason, the man in Jesus' story did. He's alone. He's going through the Valley of the Shadows, the Way of Blood. These robbers see him. They trail along for a little while, and then they ambush him. He's left for dead. He's beaten. It says they stripped him of his clothing. That is the outer garment. In our day, if somebody stole your outer garment, your cloak or your coat, well, you've probably got a couple more at home, or you could go buy one somewhere. Today, you could find one you could probably afford. But in that day, it wasn't so easy. You had a couple, maybe, of outfits, and the way you dressed depicted your standing in culture. It's who you were. It's like a uniform to those that are you associate with. And so here he is. He's beat. He's left for dead. If you were beaten, left for dead, who would you hope might wander by you? You might say, well, maybe one of you pastors. It'd be kind of good if you kind of get paid to help us, right? So maybe you'll come along and you'll help me out. Well, this is what happens to this gentleman. A priest comes by. It says in verse 31, now by chance, a priest was going down that road. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So these roads are kind of like two-lane roads. The guy's in the ditch on the right. The priest sees him at a distance. He kind of sizes up the situation, and he makes sure to go over as far as he can, lest he engages with that man. That man who may be dead, or that man who might be soon to die. Now, why would he do that? Well, the lawyer would understand this is a priest. And the priest, if he's coming from Jerusalem to Jericho, he's probably returning from his priestly duties. The tribe of Levi were the priests of Israel. All priests were Levites, but not all Levites were priests. This man had been trained and equipped to serve in the temple. And he would serve for his term. It might be months, it may be weeks. But he was there and he was serving. Now it was time to return home. He's going to see his kids. He's going to see his wife. He's going to get some home cooking. He's done his duty to the Lord, and now he's going home. On his way home, he sees a guy who's either dead or soon to be dead. If he touches him and that guy dies, he is ceremonially unclean, and he would be required by the law of God to go back to Jerusalem and go through the cleansing process. It would have required the sacrifice of a red heifer that he had to pay for. The ashes of that carcass, once it was burned, would be mixed with water. A hyssop branch would be dipped into that mixture, and it would be sprinkled on the priest. That had to happen. So now, when his family's expecting him to be back at home, he's got to turn around and make the journey 17 miles back to Jerusalem and stay there for an extended period of time till all of that could happen. So one might give him a little grace and say, we get it. He passes around the side so he can make it on home. Then Jesus says, behind him, a Levite came. When he came to the place and saw him, he passed by on the other side as well. So the Levite would have been something akin to a deacon or a praise team member or someone who serves in any volunteer capacity in our church. Missions team, whatever it may be. You had the priest. Remember, all priests were Levites, but not all Levites were priests. So you had these guys who would serve longer terms, but then you had people who did any number of tasks for the religious community that were Levites, but not priests. And that's what this guy is. He sees him, no explanation. he passes by as well. But a Samaritan came. Now, we've been seeing these Samaritans over and over in Luke's gospel. Just by way of reminder, they are half Jew, half Assyrian. When the Assyrians took over Israel, they sent their men down to marry these Jewish women and kind of try to eliminate ethnic cleansing, if you will. And so they worshiped differently. They thought differently. They didn't get along. The Jews hated the Samaritans because in their mind, they're descendants of compromisers. And so the Jews would say the only good Samaritan is a dead Samaritan. They tried to avoid Samaria. They wouldn't even speak of the Samaritans. You'll see later when the lawyer answers Jesus' question, who was the neighbor, he couldn't say the Samaritan. He said the one who showed him mercy. So the fact that he used a Samaritan, that's consequential. That's meaningful. That's not what I'm going to exploit in this text. But I do want you to see that the hero of the text was the Samaritan. So Jesus says, a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to the place where he was. When he saw the victim in the ditch, he had compassion. It's a good translation. It means that he was moved from his gut. He was moved. He felt something. Beware of getting to the place where you can see hurting people and not feel a thing. That means you need to take some time and get things right in your heart. He felt something. It didn't say whether the priest did or not. It didn't say whether the Levite felt anything or not. But when the Samaritan saw him, he was human enough that he felt compassion. He did some arithmetic in his mind, and he thought, you know, if I'd left an hour earlier, what? That could be me. Do you ever think that? Does your mind work that way when you're going down the road and you see a car accident and you realize that the person who was hurt or killed, it wasn't their fault. They were at the wrong place at the wrong time. You think to yourself, that could have been me. That could have been one of my kids. It could have been my wife. And how would I want someone to treat them if they were in this predicament? He's moved with compassion. He feels it. And it says in verse 34, he went to him, not around him. He moves toward the pain. It's a good thought. Hurting people, when you see someone hurting, we're called to weep with those who weep. Before you figure out how to help, that may be a worthy question of what is the best way to help, but always move toward the pain, not away from it. He went to him, and he bound his wounds. Where did he get the binding? Where did he get the material to bind his wounds? Well, most theologians agree that he probably had to tear it off of his own robe to bind this man's wounds. Pouring on oil and wine, the wine would have been an antiseptic. The oil would have been a balm to help seal the wound. And he set him on his own animal, probably a donkey. I don't know if you've ever picked a grown man up. It's not easy. If they weigh more than 80 pounds, it's not easy. It's dead weight. And so he takes the time to get this man up on his animal, which means the rest of the way to the next village, he's walking and allowing this man who's hurting to ride. He brought him to an inn and took care of him. So he makes sure he's got a roof over his head, that he has a place to stay where he's safe. The next day, he took out 2 denarii and gave it to the innkeeper. That's roughly a couple $100 in our vernacular. It's a day's wage for the average working man. He gave it to the innkeeper and said, you take care of him, and whatever more you spend, put it on my tab. I will repay you when I come back. They worked a deal out. He gave him his line of credit to make sure everything's taken care of. This man is able to go home to his wife, his kids, his family, and live a fruitful life if he chooses to. He would survive. Now, that's the story. Then Jesus, the master storyteller, flips the question. The lawyer had asked, who is my neighbor? But Jesus spins it around. And he said in verse 36, which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? One would expect, he would say, who was the Samaritan's neighbor? Isn't that the way we think? We identify with the hero. Who was the Samaritan's neighbor? That's not what he asked. He said, who was the victim's neighbor? And that's extremely important. And that's what I want to exploit in the time we have remaining. Who is the victim's neighbor? Which proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? Well, the lawyer knew the answer. The people hearing knew the answer. You know the answer. It says in verse 37, the one that showed him mercy. And Jesus said, bingo. Go do that. Now, if we were watching a movie or reading a book together, we would presume that the author or the producer, he has an agenda, right? And generally, he wants you to associate yourself with someone in that story or that movie. Suppose we were watching Star Wars. From the earliest scenes, he is attempting to get you to associate yourself with the saga of the Skywalkers, the ultimate heroes of the show. And so you've got a girl, you've got a guy, even the villain is a Skywalker. They're all Skywalkers. So you're to pick one and identify with that person, but you identify with the winners. You identify with the heroes, right? In Jesus' story, he says, I want you to identify with the victim. It's not where our minds go. It's not where the Jewish mind goes. It's not where anybody's mind goes. But you think of this and answer the question, who was the neighbor to the victim? Identify with the victim here. Now think about it from the victim's perspective. He had encountered three types of people. The first were the takers. Those are the robbers. The takers say, what is yours is mine, and I will take it. The world is full of takers. They wake up in the morning and say, what is in it for me today? They go to work asking, what is in it for me? They come to church and ask, what's in it for me? These are the takers. They're taking what belongs to others. They're so concerned about their own desires and their own lust that they will use you to fulfill their satisfaction, even if it hurts you or destroys you in the process. These are the takers. They're not concerned about helping others. They are concerned about helping themselves. Some of you today are singles and you're adults and you're thinking about marriage. Beware of dating a taker. Learn to see that attitude. Some of you are employers. Beware of hiring a taker. You know how you know? They never say thank you. They never show appreciation for anything. Beware of hiring a taker. Some of you are laborers. You have an employer. Beware of signing on with a taker. They also never say thank you. Beware of takers. They want to use you to take care of themselves. The first people this man encountered were the takers. Then there's a second group. Those are the keepers. These are the priests and the Levite. The keepers say, what is mine, and I shall keep it. It's the spirit of Cain who sees his brother and says, am I my brother's keeper? To which the Lord would answer, you certainly are. In other words, it's not my concern. It's not my problem. I've got my own problems to worry about. The keeper asked himself, what will happen if I stop to help? Rather than, What will happen to the victim if I do not stop to help? A Gallup survey discovered recently that 10% of the American church members, 10% of the 100, 10%, it used to be 80-20, the Pareto principle. Today it's 10% of the members of this church do 90% of the work in a church. That's all over America. 10% of the people serve on some particular basis. Of the remaining 90, 50% of that 90 said, we have zero interest in ever serving through our local church. What does that mean? It means they just don't want to get involved. There's no concern there for us. We're there to receive, we're there to keep, but we're not there to serve. The taker or the keeper thinks to himself, since I can't afford to do everything and help everybody, I will not help anybody. But what happens when you live that way? Your soul turns inward. You become isolated. You become depressed. And the only thing you have to comfort you are the things you've kept. They're the takers, the victim encountered. Some of you have encountered takers. There are the keepers. They do nobody any good. And then there's the good neighbor. That's the Samaritan. The taker says, what is yours is mine, and I will take it. The keeper says, what is mine, and I will keep it. The good neighbor says, what is mine is yours, and I will give it. He took his robe and bandaged the man. He took his flask of wine and he cleaned the man's wounds. He took his own oil and poured it as an ointment on the man's sores. He provided a roof over his head. He provided food for his stomach. He even served as a guarantee should the need grow worse. He offered his own line of credit and his good name on the man's behalf. That is a good neighbor. Everybody knew it. Everybody who heard the story, you knew it. That's the good neighbor. And remember, Jesus didn't call us to identify with him. He asked who was a neighbor to the victim. He wants you to think of yourself from the victim's perspective. Why on earth would he do that? Simply because therein lies the answer to the original question. What must I do to inherit eternal life? You've got to realize that you had been left for dead. As Paul the Apostle said it so well, and we were dead in our trespasses and sins. What can a dead man do to save himself? Nothing. Even if he had a spark of desire to do something, his legs will not serve him. His eyes cannot see. His mouth cannot speak. His ears cannot hear. His arms are limp. When it comes to spiritual reality, that is the place that we have all been in. In that condition, we have encountered people who at times make it worse. The takers, who say, I will milk all I can get out of you without giving you any hope of true salvation. We have met the keepers. Our only hope in our condition, as we relate to the victim, our only hope is that we meet the good neighbor, the Lord Jesus Christ, who takes our sin upon himself, who would heal our wounds by his stripes, who had a balm of Gilead to pour upon our head, who had a place that he had gone to prepare for us, who reached down into his own good credit with the Father and says, whatever they owe you, charge it to my account. Hallelujah. What am I trying to say? Like a good neighbor, Jesus is there. Like our friends, the Samaritans, he was despised and forsaken by men. He was mocked and he was beaten Yet he did not offer insult for insult. He hung there upon the cross with your sin upon his shoulder. And he prayed in compassion, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." Like a good neighbor, Jesus was there. I don't know about you. I don't know about those listening from our Central Nassau campus. I don't know about those hearing by radio or online today. But I can relate to that. When I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more, then the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me. What's he saying? Like a good neighbor, Jesus is there. The only hope of you inheriting eternal life is for you to see yourself like that and to look up and say, "I've seen the takers, I've seen the keepers. Is there a neighbor who can help?" And Jesus comes running to that person. And once you've experienced it, and he's lifted you out of the miry clay, and he set your feet upon the rock, he's put that coat upon the prodigal, a ring upon his finger, and he's had a banquet in your honor, it's then that you can be a good neighbor to somebody else. I came across this story this week. It was about a shoe store in Europe. It's a gentleman working there. It was one of these cold winter days. And he looks out his window and he sees a little boy. And the little boy had found one of these grates that cities have where heat rises through the grate. And the boy was barefooted. And so he goes and he's shivering cold, but he's standing on that grate to keep his little feet warm. He's just a small boy. And the guy in the shoe store is just watching him. And we do that sometimes. It's like when you're watching a car race and there's a wreck and you're just watching it. You just feel like there's nothing you can do about it. And here this man is, surrounded by shoes, seeing this little barefoot boy, snow falling, trying to keep his feet warm. And it doesn't occur to him what he should do. A middle-aged woman walks by. She sees the little boy. She has a few words with him. And then she takes him and she brings him into the shoe store. She buys him some socks. She buys him a pair of shoes. And she's there and she's settling up. She's paying for it to take care of this little boy like she ought to have done. The little boy looked up at her and said, "Ma'am, are you God's wife?" She said, "No, but I am one of his kids." Little boy said, "I knew you had to be kin to him." Once you've been adopted into the family of God, you are able to drive down the interstate, walk through the city streets, see pain, and move toward it, not away from it. To ask yourself, not, where do they go to church? Who did they vote for? Are they related to me? But to ask yourself, what will happen if I don't help? What would happen if that were me? And to love without any loopholes. To love the way you want to be loved. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And to love the hurting as you love yourself. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Let that sink in for a moment. I know there's questions that come come with helping. I know there is. I understand. But what would it take for you to move toward the pain instead of away from it? What would it take for you to say, I will be my brother's keeper? Or, it's not my problem. What if it became your problem? Just for a little while at least. Till the gal or the guy has a fighting chance. Well, what if the robbers get me too? That's a valid risk. You're right. But you know where you're going. You know you're going to make it. You don't know about him. In just a moment, we're going to pray a short prayer. And when we say amen, that's what we call here at the Baptist Church, an invitation. We're inviting you to respond. For many of us, it's just responding by having a conversation with the Lord and maybe apologizing to him and asking forgiveness for times when we took the long way around and committing to him to move toward the pain next time, not away from it. But it's also a good opportunity for those of you who say, as I look back over my life, I've certainly encountered the takers. I've encountered the keepers. I've had people who've given me a lot of stuff to do to be saved, to get God's favor. One told me I had to get baptized in his church. Another one told me that I had to take communion at his church. And I've done all these things, but I don't feel at peace. And what we're telling you today is, peace is found when Jesus comes along and you see yourself half dead on the side of the road spiritually. Unable to help yourself, but you let him take you and save you. You're rescued. You believe that you're a sinner and he is a savior, and he did everything that needed to be done on the cross. Now, when that happens to you, you do change and you do serve him and you do live differently. But you don't work for salvation, you're working from it. It's what Jesus called being born from above. And if that's never happened to you, this invitation is also for you. In just a moment, when I say amen to this prayer, I want to invite you, if you feel that the Holy Spirit is drawing and convicting you, then you step out and come. Our pastors will be here at the front. You just take one by the hand and say, I'd like to be saved. And they'll explain to you how that can happen before you leave today. If you're here and you're, the best you know as you look over your life, that has happened. But you realize that the calling of a Christian is to flock together like sheep, that we are to be around other people who've been rescued, that we can do more together than we could ever do individually. And you want to be a part of this family of faith, this church. If God's calling you to that, we would be so happy to receive you today. We had several in the early service. Maybe this is for you in the late service, and God's telling you, today's the day, this is the place. Why don't you follow through? As soon as I say amen, you also come. Bring your family. It'll only take a couple of minutes, and we'll help you make that decision. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you so much for this very familiar story, and I thank you for the jewels that we found down in that mine. May we not just look at them and say, look how pretty they are. But Lord, may we use them to serve people who are hurting for your glory. Enable us, Lord, because we have eternal life, because we've been found, to love you with all our heart and to love our neighbor as ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand. You come if the Lord's drawing.